Politburo found ways to operate. Bulgaria went first as early as 1946, the same year in which we reduced our army by 80%. In 1947, the so-called free elections in Poland turned out to be a red puppet show. One by one, the nations of Middle Europe were stamped with the hammer and sickle. While in the same period, we voluntarily disbanded and piled up huge stocks of surplus war material. The communists were testing our strength at every point of the perimeter. They had made the power play of the Berlin blockade. The free world began to react to this train of events. We had joined with other Western nations to form the North Atlantic Defense Pact, but the communist strategy is to probe where we are weak. We were getting stronger in Europe, but not nearly as strong as our potential enemies. Our forces were weakest in another spot, halfway around the world, Korea. It began with the North Koreans and the South Koreans. It was to end with a war that cost us 130,000 casualties and uncounted billions in treasure. As South Koreans reeled under the onslaught of 60,000 North Korean troops, United Nations forces were sent into what was called a police action. American troops who came ashore in this forgotten corner of the world found they were up against a tough and well-disciplined army that outnumbered them by more than 5-1. Until reinforcements could be brought ashore, these first troops had to trade space for time, and slowly they fell back. They fought bravely and well, but always they fell back. They made a stand at Taejong, but hopelessly outnumbered by the North Koreans, they were forced out after a bitter battle. Back they fell, trading space for time, until there was no more space left to trade. UN troops occupied a small triangle of Korean land. The enemy was only 30 miles from Pusan, our last good port of entry. From the few weapons we had captured, it appeared that the enemy was well supplied with small arms firepower, much of it delivered by the Russians. By now, the North Koreans were pressing hard, pressing against the shrinking perimeter. It looked as if we would be thrown off the peninsula. Meanwhile, back in the States, our firepower buildup was underway. We took our young men in and began training them intensively because we had learned that in the complex science of modern warfare, when you bring a soldier and his weapons together, it calls for something more than a casual introduction. They got acquainted with various kinds of artillery. They learned their way around a switchboard and got the hang of complex signal equipment. We taught them map reading and radar and 100 other things they had to know if they were to do their job effectively. We toughened them up and taught them to work as fighting teams. And when they finished their training, they packed their gear and went for a long boat ride to back up the men who were holding the line in Korea. Meanwhile, the North Koreans were pressing forward with the full weight of their manpower. Our situation looked dark. Then, out of this pocket of beleaguered men, there came the legend of a unit of men and weapons called the Fire Brigade. This highly mobile group was held in reserve until a point in the perimeter was threatened. Then it went into action. There were points along the line where the defenders were outnumbered 6 or 8 to 1, but they poured out a volume of fire so deadly they drove the attackers back. For 80 exhausting days and nights, our troops opposed firepower to manpower, in the right amount, at the right place, at the right time. We followed through with a brilliant surprise landing at Inchon. By December of 1950, we had broken out of the perimeter and made it to the Yalu. Then suddenly, we had a new enemy. The Chinese Communist Army, which had entered the fight with more than 1 million men. For months, their human sea attacks attempted to knock us out of the war. Time and again, their concentration of large numbers of troops provided the opportunity for the ultimate demonstration of our Army's training in coordinated firepower, the time-on-target mission. The mission begins with the sighting of a large enemy concentration of men and equipment. The target is reported. The location is plotted on the map. And the grid points phoned and radioed to every artillery piece that can reach target, together with the exact time shells should arrive on the target. One shell will take 30 seconds in flight to reach the target, another 18 seconds. It is important that all shells arrive at the same instant, for the enemy has shown his ability to disperse quickly under heavy fire. All the complex organization of supply, intelligence, fire direction, communication, all the weeks and months of training are directed toward this one moment, and then inferno. Side that was, is no more. This is what happens to an enemy who comes up against the firepower of effectively trained troops. In 1 2-week period, the Chinese suffer more than 100,000 casualties, lose more than 12,000 prisoners. 3 weeks later, an astonishing coincidence. Jacob Malik of the Russian UN delegation drops a surprise into a routine UN speech.
The Soviet people believe that as a first step, discussion should be started between the belligerents for a ceasefire and an armistice.
Weary months later, the truce is signed. And for the time being, the communist pressure is contained. It was good to have the boys home. But there was a serious note underlying these joyful greetings on the dock, for we knew then that we were living in a world in which we must never again show ourselves weak and unprepared. Out of this awareness of danger, we have continued to guard our outposts with unwinking vigilance. Having seen the international handwriting on the wall, we keep close watch. We patrol the sea with new and improved craft, above, on, and below the sea. But meanwhile, the communists continue to practice their annoying habit of probing where we are weak. After learning to say with difficulty, Panmunjom, we learn to say with anger, Dien Bien Phu. We have learned to say with puzzlement, Tachin Islands, Upper Tachin, Lower Tachin, Kimoi, Matsu. What are we to do? Shall we turn ourselves into a nation of soldiers, maintaining the maximum in power at the farthest reaches of our defense perimeter? The fact is that we can't afford it, and the temper of our people is against it. Unlike the communists, who consider the individual to be chaff, we care about every child, every man. We want him home with his children. building the peaceful strength of our nation. But we have learned that to be without a trained army and trained reserves makes these homes naked to our enemies. Fortunately, the United States Army Reserve provides a way between, gives us the opportunity to build our power, including firepower, for peace. At training camps and reserve centers like these, American men supplement their civilian skills with the training they need to master the complex know-how of today's Army. With today's weapons, the trained individual is more powerful and more important than ever. For the first time in history, Americans are waking up to the fact that we don't have to have wars if we have strength. By means of these classrooms and firepower, we protect the classrooms where our children learn the ideals of a free people. Here is the real source of our strength, the power of the free ballot, by which our people choose how they will be governed. This precious heritage needs protection from rulers who have never permitted a free election. The power of the spirit to choose. The power that binds our homes and families together. The power of all the thoughts and traditions that make our nation great. All these depend on America's strength in reserve.